We're live. We are live.
We are live.
We are live. Welcome, everybody.
We're live.
We're live. Live.
We're live.
We're live.
We're live. Thank goodness.
Yes.
I was scared slightly, just momentarily, but we did it.
We did it. We're here. We're live.
So the last episode was...
You're just going right in.
What?
We gotta introduce who the Andrew is.
Settle down, Ruben. He wants us out of here fast.
I think so. We started a little bit later than we anticipated. First, I just want to say I apologize for my voice. It sounds like I'm about to cry. I have a frog in my throat, and it's a cold that just isn't going away. I'm not contagious anymore, I don't think.
Oh, okay.
It's just, and it sounds worse than it feels, so I just want to make that clear. Thank you. And I'm Ryan, and with me as always, well, not as always, with me frequently on this podcast is my brother Ruben, who I started the show with. And with me to my right, and to your viewers left, is Andrew, who is guesting with us again, live in person, for more continuous coverage of Rocky V.
Can't wait. I'm very excited.
Well, it's happening right now. You don't have to wait.
Yeah,
I'm still excited.
This is literally it.
Oh, well, we haven't started the movie where we had left off, so I'm kind of like really, I can't wait to get back into the story.
Okay, but I was going to say last episode that aired.
Okay, sorry, yeah.
Is the... Grant interview.
Two ago. Yeah, so this is episode 105. 103, we interviewed Richard Gant. And he just finished talking here in this scene about wanting Balboa to fight Union Kane. And we ended that episode with Andrew before the interview with Richard Gant about Adrian coming up here to say that her husband has retired. Mm-hmm. So we stopped that recording with you, I think, at that moment. So
this is where we left off.
Okay, perfect. So, yeah, for those who haven't heard, if you haven't listened to it already, go listen to my interview with Richard Gant. It was amazing.
I can't wait to listen to it.
So my brother, Ruben, probably has heard, out of all of our listeners, he's probably heard the least amount of episodes. Not only do I get to listen to the episodes and do the interviews, I get to edit everything, too. So I get to hear myself more than I would actually like to.
Bless your heart.
Thank you.
We are also videoing it. Just to let you know, Andrew, you got a hair out of place.
Oh, I got plenty out of place. It's just the way it is.
So thanks for everyone watching us live and watching the video afterwards. This video will be edited for iTunes for later use if you don't want to watch our faces and stuff like that. We can understand. So we're going to do the watch a scene or two, a sentence or two in the film. Talk about what's going on and what our thoughts are on it. So Adrian here is about to say, "My husband is retired." Okay, so that's true. He has nothing more to prove. What more does the Rocky character have to prove?
That's it. You know, it's cool because they started this retirement process in 3, and then in 4 it comes up again, and then now it's like this is it. It's it. He's retired. He has climbed every mountain. There's no more mountain left to climb.
Yeah,
it's over
until you get to Rocky Balboa.
Well, we'll see. I know. The only reason why Rocky could fight in Rocky Part 6, Rocky Balboa, is because Adrian is dead.
Yes.
We love Adrian, but boy, she's sure...
She's a buzzkill sometimes.
She's a box block. She's like, a bit of a box block. You know, she blocks a lot of Rocky's ambitions to box.
Yeah, like that time. Cares about him. Like that time he wanted to avenge Apollo's death, and she got all crazy on him and was like, "You can't win." God.
Well, you know, I think Stallone writes what he knows.
Sure.
He's been married a few times.
He's been married.
No, it makes sense. I don't think my wife would be too thrilled when we're getting punched in the face a whole bunch of times.
Especially if the money's been made.
If you're well off, why get punched anymore?
No.
Just stop.
Now look at Rocky's face here after Adrian says, "My husband has retired, he has nothing else to prove." Is he looking dejected that Adrian's announcing this? Is he still not quite behind retiring?
Well, he's never been a confident man.
Okay.
I think there's that. There's a little bit of...
I like it. No, yeah, he's... Yeah, he's... Okay, let's keep going.
So public responsibility to respond now rather than later?
Okay, this guy bugs me, that reporter. He's saying, don't you consider it a public responsibility to respond now rather than later? Adrian just announced that he's retired.
Yeah, but...
So she's saying he's retired. That is his response. His team or his family has announced his retirement. The reporter, I think, is trying to say, you know, are you responding to the Union Cane challenge? Like, would you rather, you know, you should respond right now to the challenge. But this public responsibility, he doesn't owe the public anything. You know, he certainly doesn't owe that reporter. He's really brash the way he... The press in Rocky Five... A brash reporter, yeah. The reporters in Rocky Five are over the top.
I feel like this press conference didn't impress me at all, you know? Public, like...
Well, I keep on waiting for Cobra to return.
Oh,
yeah.
I just got brought up Cobra.
Well, yeah, if you Google Cobra, these are the Cobra glasses.
Yeah, look, I know the jacket's a little off. It's more. He's got, you know, some money in the bank, but is it the leather?
Yeah, he's got the leather jacket there, and that is the.
Like, he would know that he is dressing like the Cobra character.
Now Rocky is bigger here than he was in Rocky IV. You can tell his frame is larger. Sylvester Stallone, you know, 10 years later or 15 years after Rocky IV, he's a bigger, kind of bigger man. So you can almost tell this jacket is fitting a little bit wider mm-hmm. than it did in Rocky IV, even though this took place just moments after Rocky IV.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
So this reporter, I think, repeats the question.
Respond to the people. I mean, isn't this a question of professionalism to talk about it now, not later?
Why is he? Look at this guy. Look how angry he is. Talk about it now, not later. Well, number one, what is he responding to? Just the challenge or his retirement? And he literally didn't have 2 seconds to breathe before they're telling him, you know, to respond. Like, give him a second to breathe and think about an answer.
I think it's interesting. Like, you know, you were talking with in the interview with Richard Gant. They were talking about some of the problems that plague this particular production and the public perception that this is the least favorite of the series. And I think that one of the things that was noted is that the writing in a lot of these, like, a lot of the subcontext, like this particular scene, I just don't think it was, like, put together well. You know, the questions, like, we're talking about it right now, he just sort of kind of absurd, almost.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're trying to over-sensationalize the
his tough
thing. But
his,
he's such a tough reporter.
Yeah.
Look at him. He just, look at that snarling face.
Oh, he's I would love it if Rocky punched him in the face right now.
Okay, I don't know. Is that the same guy?
It might be.
Older?
Kent H. Johnson, okay.
If it is, he's in a bunch of Rocky movies.
Really?
Look at this.
As the art department, though. Interesting.
I'm under actor. This art department, yeah.
Okay.
But for actor, he's in Rocky V.
As a reporter.
As a reporter.
He's got one acting credit.
But.
That is him.
But he's got a bunch of.
No, that's what I mean. Those are those myriad of. That's
art.
Yeah, the art department.
Property master, yeah, supervisor.
Property, so he's a property master. What is that? Do you know? He's a master of property.
Well, here's for rapid fire. He was a weapons supervisor.
Okay.
So he's probably a weapons supervisor again.
Interesting. Well, look at this guy. This is his one acting role. We're going to get him.
Okay. If he's a weapons supervisor. It looks like he's a weapons supervisor.
He's got supervisor.
He's got the eyes of the tiger. That's what he has.
Right now, he definitely does.
He definitely has eye of the tiger. Alex just said in our chat, we got Isabella from Australia. Hey, Isabella, how's it going?
Hey, Izzy.
Hi.
Welcome. Alex just said, the son of George Washington Duke is in Creed 2. So the character, I presume, or the actor's son, if you want to clarify that, Alex, in what part? So that's interesting. I didn't know that.
All right. Ooh, no, I think he's alluding to the fact that it's... That it's Richard Gant's son.
Richard Gansfield, is it? Okay.
Yeah. I mean, it would have been pretty prevalent, like, in the... You guys have seen Creed 2.
Yes.
The storyline would have had been like, oh, this is...
Yeah, I guess something would have been brought up, so maybe...
Son, so it has to be sort of alluding to the actor.
And Rocky, I love his the way he responds to this kind of pressure. He uses humor, and he's like, mind if I heal first? But it's, you know, funny, but not funny. Like, he's really beaten up. He's injured.
Sure.
His head's hurting. And he's telling the reporter, do you mind if I heal first, you know, before I talk about things that you guys are yelling at me to talk about?
I heal first.
The whipping you got ain't nothing like what I got here for.
Okay.
So what in the hell?
So this Union Cane guy, bless his heart, he's not an actor. Richard Gant, in my interview with him, talked about Union Cane. Mm-hmm. His name, I forget again. I think it's something like Kevin Douglas or something like that. I forget his name. I apologize to the actor Union Cane. But that being said, he says that he will give a bigger beating to Rocky than Drago gave him. Yeah.
Michael Anthony Williams.
Thank you, Ruben.
Yes.
Ruben Google.
Not to be confused with Michael Anthony, the bass player for Van Halen.
No, that's why he went Michael Anthony Williams.
Yeah. It's just So you don't get confused.
There's a couple differences between Michael Anthony and Michael Anthony Williams. One of them is a boxer.
Sure. One, yeah, the other one's a bass player.
One's a bass player. Yeah.
And then there's not to be confused with Michael Anthony Hall from Johnny and His Fame.
Wow. Yeah, that's
right. Michael Anthony is
a Dead Zone. So Alex said that he's the charter promoter for Drago. So that character. So you're saying the character? Okay. All right. Interesting. I did not know that. All right. Thank you, Alex.
Cool tidbit.
So Richard Gant or George Washington Duke here says, so what in the hell does this all mean?
No, that isn't enough. We got to hear about this now.
Yeah, think about that. So anyway, I want to tell everybody that the flight over was really nice.
That's great.
That's a great mullet back there on the right hand side.
Oh yeah, look at this guy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Holy, he looks a little stoned. Looks a little. He's got his tie on, you know. He's a good reporter.
Yeah, he's business in the front.
One thing I'm noticing there is like a couple of these cameras. Like, look at this one.
This is a point and shoot. That's like a Fuji film.
What is it? Yeah. Who is that? That tourist who just stumbled in there.
This guy looks Russian. Looks like he got off the plane. And he's merged himself in as a reporter. What else we got here? We got the welcome sign back here. You know, welcome home. Yeah. Is that Kanye West? It looks Kanye. Another long-haired fellow back here.
Looks like John Cougar Mellencamp, that guy. Yeah.
So this reporter is actually, my understanding, it's the same reporter that was in part one that interviewed him in the meat locker.
Oh wow.
Yeah, and she's the one. She spoke in our previous episode that we did together. She had the speaking part. She was one of the first reporters to speak, and I believe she's the same reporter. Yeah, and she's a reporter in real life.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Is that Cindy Roberts? I think we talked about her before.
Yeah. And she's on Twitter, and I've tried to get a hold of her. I will still try because I'd love to get a hold of her because she's been in two Rocky films playing that reporter.
Also the A-Team?
Wow. Babe Rock's wife? Or
There's got to be an A-Team podcast somewhere.
Don't give anyone any ideas. That's what the Wicked do after the Rocky podcast.
Call us, please.
Yeah. All right. Here we go.
Guys, we need more.
Oh, Adrian, you know, if you weren't with me, I never would have done as good.
So here he is talking to Adrian. It's really sweet. And also deflecting the reporter.
Classic Rocky.
Right.
Classic Rocky.
You're my Adrian. You're always there, you know. Well, she wasn't always there. She came later. But anyways.
You're my Adrian. You're always there, you know. And my kid, having you, is like being born all over again.
Come on, what are you saying?
So he says having you is like being born all over again, and this will play later into the film, where I think he says the same thing to Tommy when he's training Tommy. He mentions that having Tommy in his life and training Tommy is like being born all over again. So
yeah,
that's one of those things that will haunt his son. He hears this, and he, of course, loves it, but he's going to hear it be said to Tommy, I think, later in the film. So now the reporter is asking, are you going to retire or not? So again, the wife has spoken. Maybe this is misogynistic of the report. The wife has already spoken for her husband.
Yeah, I mean, like, I think it's like one of those things where, like, the characters of, like, Adrian and Rocky, they're quite old-fashioned, you know what I mean?
Sure.
And so I think that Rocky, you know, when that sort of moment, we sort of saw the look on his face, and you kind of see him kind of like, my wife's doing the talking. Sure. I'm a little bit emasculated by it, but, like, you know, her word is the law. I'm not going to even comment on it. So he just moved his way through everything.
My wife talks for me all the time, and that's just fine by me. It's gotten to the point, I've told the story on our show before, Ruben, but Andrew, I don't think you've heard this yet. And it's almost embarrassing to tell, but my mother-in-law asked Becky, my wife, like, does Ryan like, I forget what the food was. Or she, you know, or she asked me if I liked whatever. And I actually asked Becky, do I like that? Like, I actually asked her, is this a food item that I enjoy? I'm not even, no.
When you say almost embarrassing.
Okay.
You can just take up the almost.
Okay, roger that. All right. Okay.
That's funny, though.
It is kind of funny.
It is, yeah.
All right. I can laugh at myself.
Good.
The whole world laughs with me, right?
So, sure, yeah.
Or at me. All right.
Well, in this case, just a few hundred.
Just a few viewers. Oh, my wife's watching. She heard the story. Hey, honey, how's it going?
I like how it just shows up there that she is watching.
She is watching.
Like she's watching
always,
you.
She's always watching.
She's always watching. We love Becky very much. I speak highly of her all the time. Right, everybody?
You do.
Right? Okay. All right.
Hey, are you going to retire or not?
I'd like to go home.
Are you going to give us something to write?
Thank
what do you
very
say?
Much. I appreciate it.
No!
He's so committed.
He is.
Don't worry. You'll get him. You'll get him.
That's a foreshadow.
Yeah. So this is a great little sequence here. This guy here, again, I can't recommend this interview enough, not to toot my own horn, but this interview that I did with Richard Gant, this individual here, talks about this actor here. This is the cop.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this guy was a cop. Mm. And he gives a little story about the his life and the big case that he cracked. And it's really cool. So that's who he's talking about. So those who are watching this and have heard the interview, that's who he's referring to. And again, I forget his name in real life. Sorry. And my wife just messaged that she's always watching. And Jeff mentioned that the world does laugh at me. Thank you, Jeff. All right, the nice limo ride home. The Balboa State.
Do people still do limos?
Sure. Trump. And others.
I think one thing's really awesome to note, like, is in 3, 4, and 5... there's three different houses.
Yes. Right? Well, they've moved. It's simple. It's not a continuation. They move with every...
They move in the short period of time in between movies.
Sure. Yeah.
I think it's kind of like when I've had this question so many times over the years. Maybe we even touched on it, the timeline, the last episode that I was on.
Yeah.
Is that like Rocky or Sly has sort of said that it's just sort of like they just replace everything. It's the same story, but it's just...
Sure, it has
to be reflective of the time. And it's just, that's the way that it is. He doesn't have any desire to have any continuation of the original, like, or sure. The previous story. It'll just be where it is. And, like, that's a perfect example. He's like, yeah, there's the house. We'll just pick that house.
Not like a,
that's where Rocky lives now.
A BBC, sure. Like, Downton Abbey.
That's what that house looks
like? No. Like, so you have to continue. It's a period piece. Totally. You know, we're going to stay there. And if he did that, we wouldn't have the robot.
No, speaking of the robot, we'll touch on it later, but the robot was supposed to be in this film. But it was in Europe at the time. And Stallone wanted the robot to be there for the auctioning of their items.
Wow.
He did want it there in the film. So there would have been that really continuation from Part 4. When Part 5 was made, it's a true continuation of the events of Part 4.
Mm-hmm.
But he wanted the robot in this film. I think it would just make this film that much more enjoyable by all our fans. They're Rocky.
Just one glimpse of a robot. It would have just brought it back up a couple notches.
Yeah, absolutely. Sophie just chimed in and said, hi, I have that Mighty Mick t-shirt as well. So awesome, Sophie. Yeah, it's a great shirt. A coworker gave this to me, so shout out to my coworker, Paul. That's very kind of you. So there's a nice shot of the house here.
That's somebody's house, though, you know?
No, yeah.
Really, it's great. Look at this place.
It's different.
I swear, I ain't never leaving this place again, you know?
Okay, foreshadow? Like, in about 10 minutes, you're going to find out. All right.
I was just kind of curious what Rotten Tomatoes scored Rocky at. Rocky 5.
Yeah, let's talk about what it is.
Sure, I don't... critics, 29%. Audience, 31%. Which I think they're just ragging on it.
Right.
Because IMDb has it at 5.2, I think.
Well, that's audience members of Rotten Tomatoes rated it that low.
But sometimes people, you know, they hate to hate, you know?
Well, the unfortunate thing about Rocky V is, if you think about it, it's the fifth film in a franchise. So if you're watching Rocky V, chances are you're a Rocky fan, that you've gone on this journey, and here you are in Part 5. And we know that it divided audiences. And there are people who swear by this film, who love this film. There's people who this is their favorite film. If not, after Rocky 1, it's their favorite film. They love Rocky 5. It's loved by many, but it's hated and not loved by many. So I think that just brings that average score down. And so you got people saying 8, 9, 10. But then the majority of people are saying it's 1 out of 2 or, you know, or 1 out of 10, 2 out of 10. So it heavily divides people. A positive review here was, for example, a sloppy but good-natured reminder of just what it is that has kept Rocky Balboa afloat for 14 years.
This review is hilarious. Unnecessary, lazy sequel is overly violent.
Overly violent. Wow.
Wow. In this boxing movie.
Yeah. Well, the street fight, right?
But overly.
So, our father Carmine just chimed in and said, I just wanted to drop in and say hi. I'm at work again. I'll catch the replay. Great work, guys. You bet, Carmine. Don't get in trouble on our sake. This show is not worth anyone's job.
I think it is.
Yeah, maybe.
It's a good story. How come we got fired? Rocky podcast going the distance.
Yeah, where can I find that?
I swear, would you like to dance? Aww. Huh? How about a homecoming dance with your old man?
No, don't be silly. It's cold. Oh,
come here, I'll warm you up, young lady. Come on, have a dance. Hurry up, the music's almost over. Doom, 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 doom. You like the song?
Now, that's a real face right there.
Yeah. Wouldn't it be kind of weird watching your dad act with another woman?
Yeah, that's his dad in real life. As we know, Sage Sloan's father, dancing with Adrian, his on-screen wife. Yeah, but I love the face that he makes here.
Yeah, no, it's real. It rings true.
Yeah, but it's a little bit true, though. Rocky's being a little bit silly here. Like, I love my wife, but if I go on the car ride after a trip, chances of me, like, let's start dancing.
I don't know. He took a lot of punishment, I think.
Yeah.
Rocky's always been a little childlike, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think, and it's like, when as soon as they got off the plane, I think you could see in the Rocky Jr.'s face and Robert's face, something was off, like right away. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I think that was sort of like the continuation, the foreshadowing of like what's really going on.
So I wonder, yeah, good point. I wonder if Robert's seeing his dad being a little bit more punchy than normal. That he's starting, like, so he's seeing that his dad's acting, you know, weirder than normal. Like, you know, like you said, he's always been a little bit childlike, a little bit playful. That's fine. That's a great way to be. But in this instance, we as an audience and Robert's kind of seeing that Rocky's being a little bit too dopey, a little bit too goofy.
Mm-hmm.
So either he's hiding something or, yeah.
No, something's out.
He's overcompensating.
Yeah.
Paul, the guy who gave me this shirt actually just chimed in and said that you're out of dress, which is a military term that you're not dressed properly.
Did he say this to me?
Yeah.
That I'm out of dress?
Yeah. I'm not sure. Because I'm wearing the Rocky shirt. I think because you're not in a Rocky shirt.
You brother is out of dress.
Your brother. You probably say your brother.
Well, learn how to write, Paul.
Oh, there you go. Here we go.
It started.
Throw the first punch. Yeah. Paul's going to come back with something.
Next podcast, you should just wear the red, white, and blue striped shorts, and that's it. A couple of boxing
gloves. Who says I'm out right now? Well, yeah, that's it, though.
Maybe he wants you out of your dress. Maybe that's what it is. He gave us a winky face. Okay, good.
I have to check out your armpit hair.
You should rest.
Yeah, I know.
I'm tired.
Oh, yeah? Well, maybe I'll take you upstairs and violate you like a parking meter.
Whoa! Hey, yo!
Oh, yeah, yo!
Hey, yo! PG-13.
That joke reminds me of, like, watching Three's Company as an adult. So I watched it when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Jokes.
Okay, now what does he mean? Okay, let's, as well as we can without being too blue, what's the metaphor here?
He's going to park without paying.
Yeah, he's going to leave his car there and he's not going to pay for the space.
I always, how should I say
this? I'm going to violate you like a parking
meter. I always thought it meant, you know, putting quarters in a slot. That's how I see it. But you're not violating a parking meter by giving it money. You're violating it by not using it properly, right? By running it over maybe, not paying. I'm just confused by the. I'm truly confused by the metaphor, and I'm not trying to be crass because this is a PG to PG-13 podcast. But I don't know the metaphor.
So I googled it.
Okay.
And the only thing that really comes up is Rocky Five. So this is not like a saying.
No, this didn't become a thing, and this wasn't a thing before this film.
Yeah.
She's got a really cute face here, by the way. It's a nice smile. All right. So he's gonna violate like a parking meter. I'm gonna say that to my wife one day. Hey, honey. I'm going to take you to the bedroom and violate you like a parking meter. Yeah, let's see if it works.
It'll cost you a quarter.
Yo, Adrian.
She went there.
Yeah. And he says, where'd you learn to talk dirty like that? So, you know, she plays along, but I still don't get... Anyways, whatever. Looking for loose change? I don't know. Anyways.
Uncle Polly. You know something strange about Dad?
Oh, there we go. So, yeah, I mean, I've seen this movie 100 times, but, of course, Robert brings up right here that, hey, Uncle Paulie, did you notice something strange about Dad? So he's concerned about the way his dad's acting.
Yeah. And just to go back and flog a dead horse with a violet parking meter.
Please.
I think it's just, it's Rocky's cute way of being disgusting.
Okay. Yeah, he's... You
know? He's gross, like all the rest of us guys. We're just gross.
Sure, men are terrible.
Totally gross.
We're terrible people.
We mask it with cute things frequently.
Paul's wearing here, eh? He's got a cigar in his mouth, that hat. Looks like he just walked off the set of The Godfather.
Yeah, see, Paulie's never had, like...
Yeah, dress for the parts you want, you know?
Yeah.
That's right.
He just took a few hard shots.
I think you tell better jokes than me, Adrian.
Paulie was never known for his fashion sense, right?
No.
Did I hear somebody call for their old man? Did you do this? Hey, sleep time, kid, okay?
Dad, did you know that your bones grow 3 times as fast during the night?
No, I didn't know that, but I heard something like that once.
So, yeah, so Robert, you know, is showing off what he's learned in school. Because we talked about he's getting straight A's or something at the airport, he mentioned. So, this is before Google. That's pretty good. He retained this information by studying in his textbooks.
He read something.
I was so jealous of his aquarium.
Yeah,
when I was a kid, I was like, holy cow, like, out of everything, that was it for me.
So, Paul brought up that there was an airport code on his bag. Paul, if you want to elaborate what that might mean, but I did know Paulie's bag had some writing on it. I figure it was from the airport, but I don't know if it means anything.
Good catch.
Is that me?
Oh yeah, that's you.
So look at this Stallone fishing, or Rocky fishing.
They really captured him.
That's amazing. So we're led to believe, of course, that I always love it in movies where they show a picture that we think the actor has drawn. And they always show them doing like a little bit of touch up at the end there. Like, I'm just.
Yeah.
You know, there's no way that this kid drew this. It was a true artist on the set. That
really good shadowing.
Right.
I don't know. It's got some childlike qualities to it. I think a kid could have done that. An artistic kid. I think easily.
Yeah.
Excellent. Now, is that me? Right?
Yeah.
Oh, we was fishing, right?
Yeah. That's
beautiful. Look at the tent.
So, he's doing a really great job here supporting his son's artwork. You know, this is what we went fishing, right? No, Dad, this is what we went golfing, you moron. But anyways, that's not my kids would probably say that. Dad, you're an idiot.
But, so, the CAP on Paulie's luggage,
okay,
from what I can tell, is airport in Haiti.
Oh. Okay, so maybe Paulie's been around the block.
Yeah, but anyways, so good to know him as a Paul that knows that.
Yeah. Good job, Paul. Good catch.
It's from an airport in Haiti.
Oh, good job, Paul. There you go. He did the work for us. Maybe
why?
Maybe Paul could be the Google
guy. Why am I here?
You were the Google guy, but it looks like...
Paul, I'm sorry I said anything about your spelling, okay? You're outshining me.
He's taking over your job.
Sheesh.
Rodney just chimed in and said, never heard Rocky talk of the fishing before. So this is what happens when you break down this film the way we do. You'll probably, people saw that part but didn't click in, but when you pause and stop and talk about it, you say, oh yeah, he talks about fishing.
He seemed like the guy that would like fish off the dock.
Yeah. Rock dock. Yeah.
No, he used to punch people and collect money down at the docks.
That's right.
Yeah.
So maybe he broke some thumbs and busted some legs and went fishing on breaks.
Did some fishing?
Yeah.
You know, the fish was a lot bigger, if I recall.
Well, actually, right? That was a lot smaller.
Yeah. Anyway, come on. Hit the bait.
So there's a great scene coming up. You ready to talk about it? I need the title, The French Teacher. Do we have to... Is it nudity for the show? We'll find out. Let's see if it...
No. It's art.
Okay. All right. That's
the
true.
Nudity was flown in the shower.
That's true. Right, that's true. We had that on for a while.
We've already been down this
way. Yeah.
It's time for you to get healthy and everything. This is great how you do this. I don't know where you learned this.
Now, it's interesting because Stallone in real life is a painter.
Oh, yeah. He's got some really expensive artwork out there.
And so I find this interesting that, you know, this is the crazy thing about this film and all the Rocky films is how much of his real life is talked about in the film. So his son, you know, drew this picture in the film, but he says, oh, where'd you get this artwork? Well, Stallone does incredible artwork.
I wonder if Stallone did it.
He doesn't do that type of work. He might have.
Well, I'm saying, yeah.
Yeah, he might have. But he does his own artwork that's quite amazing. Some of his paintings are really cool.
It's something out of this thing comes out of your fingers.
Now, before we see the picture here, let's check out his room here. He's got the Philadelphia 76ers. And he has a poster of his father and Apollo facing each other here before the
Super Fight 2.
Super Fight 2. That's right. It's pretty cool.
We need that poster.
Oh, he's got a Nintendo.
So, imagine if your father...
It's got the Nintendo with the blaster on top.
I've never seen the Nintendo before. He's got skis, of course. So this just shows how rich.
Rich kids.
Money. Yeah, he's got his skis laying up against whatever Nintendo up there. And his own art studio, essentially.
Yeah.
It looks like there's another drawing underneath here of Stallone again.
It does.
He has like a big head there.
Yeah.
So he's flipping through his son's artwork.
Sure.
Comes across what I consider to be Robert's greatest drawing that he's ever done.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Who's this?
So, who's this? I love how it's a person. He could have just said, yeah, there's nobody, Dad. It's just a female.
Sure. What I find odd about this is that Stallone wrote this.
Sure.
With his son to act in it.
Right.
It's awesome. So he wrote to show this to his son.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
well, this is before the internet too, right? So these, you know, these poor boys didn't have anything to surf, so they had to draw their own.
Her cheekbones are quite.
Now that's what I've noticed about this picture. So you see her.
Looks like Skeletor.
Yeah. Almost like she has a flesh mask on. Like she's put on somebody else's face.
Yes.
Do you remember her in the original or the Batman with Michael Keaton and Jack Nicholson? You remember that when they gave.
Oh, yeah.
Now with Smiley and her. Yeah. Love that Joker. That's what she looks like.
Oh, yeah.
For anyone, that's an obscure. Batman reference on a Rocky podcast.
No, that's fine. That. Absolutely. It is allowed. We'll allow any reference you want. We have no rules here.
Perfect. I got an infinite amount of them.
So let's find out who it is.
I don't mean to freeze it on this. I apologize. This is not, you know, okay, but I want to talk Ruben's, about Repose here.
Ryan's an art lover.
Yeah, well, what I love is that she doesn't have armpit hair, and she's French.
All the little details.
That's Madame DuPont, my French teacher.
Really? Yeah, she looks French, sure.
That's great. That's great writing. She looks French, sure. Without the armpit hair.
I wouldn't show this to your mother because she don't understand French too good.
That's great. That's a good little father-son moment. He didn't shame his son, you know, exploring that part of his brain at the age of 13, 14, and just gave him a little bit of advice like, hey, you might... Just, your mom might not quite understand what
you're
doing.
It was kind of reassuring. He was like, oh, yeah, no, she looks French.
Yeah, she looks French.
Showed some enthusiasm and then just gave him some, you know.
She looks like my grade 7 teacher.
Grade 7? Mrs. A?
Mrs. Archibald. She was rather voluptuous as well. But she was English speaking. So, what do you got to say here?
We're the same teacher.
I swear she... Yeah. Oh. Okay. I didn't say, well, she didn't quite look like Madame DuPont, but I'm just thinking when I was about that age, I would have noticed my teacher having the same type of
stuff.
So, Rube, you Googled Madame DuPont?
Yeah, sorry, I missed Mrs. A there.
I hope she's still alive.
Who cares? Hold that old bag. She's rude. she was so
mean. She wasn't very nice. No, she canceled her
camp. I joined a choir, and she singled me out. I did the audition, you know, by the piano, and then we were all doing a practice together. She said, somebody's off as well sing. I think it's this half. So just this half sings. I think it's this corner, you know, and it came down to me. And then it's okay, ding, 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 la, 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 la. She's like, did you even audition? And I was like, yeah, out. I got kicked out of grade 6 choir, elementary school.
Wow. It's like, amazing there was even a boy that joined.
You know what I mean? Like, what a hag. Anyways.
Yeah.
She sounds mean.
I just hate. This is a grade 7 teacher.
Voluptuous, but mean.
Yeah, she wasn't nice like Madame DuPont.
Wait, there's a lot of stuff on Madame DuPont.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's got a cult following. That picture is probably worth a lot of money.
Well, Urban Dictionary, you gotta be careful.
Yeah.
Oh, DuPont is a commonly used French name that appears in many textbook workbooks and French exercise papers. However, when it's anagrammed, it becomes DuPont.
You know, I think it's interesting that Stallone would have written that name.
Sure.
He would have known that this is a common French. Yeah.
Yeah, you would have come up with that name.
Oh, God. Better cover that one up. Well, chap, it's bedtime. Hey, you know what? I know some French talk. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Madame.
Madame who?
Madame foot's caught in the door.
That's an old joke.
Oh, boy. You know... I love dad jokes, and now that I'm a father, this makes me chuckle more probably than it would at Robert's age, but as a father, it's great. I like it. And then he's trying to bond with his son, and I don't know. It's adorable, though it's a little goofy. Somebody did point out in our chat here, and they're absolutely correct. Check out that aquarium.
Yeah.
Was that you?
I brought it up. That's one of my apologies. Favorite things in the...
Yeah, I was always like...
I never really noticed until now. That's a really bad A aquarium.
Yeah, that's great. Do you know why there's not such a thing as mom jokes? Like, people say, oh, that's a dad joke.
Right, because they don't have any sense of humor.
Because girls aren't funny?
Yeah, that's why.
All right,
everybody knows
this. All right, that's right.
The moms are worried all the time. They have no time for jokes.
Sure, we'll say that.
I want to love for me. I'm trying. I don't know all the good things, you know. Whoa, what's this?
What?
Look what I found in your ear. Russian money. Huh? Money ears. All right. Anyway, listen, kid, you gotta get your...
So that's kind of cute. He brought home Russian currency. Mm-hmm. When I go sailing in foreign countries, I often, and I always do bring home currency from the countries
that... You never show me any?
To my kids.
Oh, wow.
This is his son. So when I come home, yeah, sorry.
Oh, Clover.
Hmm. No, but have you been to what some of the foreign countries you've been to?
I've been to the United States.
Okay.
But I've also been to Guatemala, Nicaragua, El Salvador, Costa Rica, Brazil.
Nice.
Italy.
Nice. Italy, nice. I've been to a couple of those as well. I've been to Costa Rica and Guatemala. Or sorry, not Guatemala, Guam. My apologies.
Guam. Very different.
Chile. Panama, Mexico, Ecuador, Puerto Rico, Croatia, Gulf of Oman, and then I just did Singapore, Singapore, boy, I'm forgetting. I just did it like a few months ago. Australia, Hawaii, yeah, stuff like that. So.
United Emirates.
Yeah, I was there too.
Oh, so your kids have lots of foreign money.
Yeah, yeah. I'm a sailor, says Paul. That's the life of a sailor. Paul's been to a lot of ports too. I can't think of them all off the top of my head, but so that just stems from, you know.
It's where we get Paul O'Day's heard from.
I find the currency is the best.
Yeah.
Sorry, what was that? I missed the joke. I missed it. It's something about Father's Day.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like this, to remind you of where you've been.
Yeah.
Dear Dad.
Yeah. I got a family in every port. Is what they say. But yeah, it's currency, I think, is the best thing. I don't do the trinkets and stuff you buy at those little stands because they're all useless. But I think the currency is cool because it's really, that's something.
Authentic, yeah.
Dad?
And kids are poor. They need money.
They think it's real money.
Sure, sure.
Today when you said having me was like being born again?
Yeah.
What did you mean?
Well, you know, when you come up like I did and you got like, 3 square meals of 0 a day. What do you mean? You got the A side of life and the B side of life. I'm like on the B side. But you got all the breaks. So when I see you having all these things that I didn't have, I like live through your eyes. I enjoy it a little bit. It's like having it all over again.
That's a true point. I mean, my kids have things that I never had growing up, obviously just because of A, technology is different than it was, you know, 40 years ago. But that's how I feel like at Christmas time.
Sure, yeah. Yeah.
And I try.
Well, yesterday, my kids were looking through our photo albums, and it showed like her Christmas of my gifts.
Sure.
There was like 3 things in a whoopee cushion.
My kids just got a whoopee cushion for Christmas.
Oh, really?
They love it.
It's fantastic.
The gift that keeps on giving.
Yeah.
I have my own built-in one. I don't need a toy. Stupid joke.
Well, when I was a kid, I had a whoopee cushion, and my son's getting one too.
There you go. It. There
fantastic.
You go.
Fantastic.
So, what Rock is saying here about that born again is we sometimes you got to be careful. You don't try to live your life again through your children's eyes, like, but you try to make sure they don't have the same trials and issues that you had as a kid, because the whole point of this world, and I think having children, is to make the world a better place by giving your kids a better life than they give their kids a better life. And that's kind of how the world gets better, is if everyone can have a better life of learning, growing, even just stuff. Like, they shouldn't be worse off than I was. That'd be terrible. Not that I was bad off. I'm saying, why? That'd be horrible if they had even less than I had.
Sure.
There was no progression. Like,
well, progress forward.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I always found that it was like growing up and when it was time for me to have my kids, that they were just there to go get cigarettes for the grown-ups.
Do you remember when we would do that? We would go get cigarettes for our next door neighbor.
Did we buy cigarettes for them?
Tanya.
That's why I had Francisco.
Did we buy cigarettes for them?
The one door over, the mom should make pink lemonade for us. We'd play Then she gave us a, she gave us a note. At least I should give me and the other kid.
You must have been, you must have been you that got them. But I believe it.
We go to 7-Eleven.
I used to get sent to the Mount Duck Market with a note.
Yeah, I know. All you needed back in the day.
Just a note. And then pretty soon, you had shown up enough times that you didn't need anything.
You're a regular kid customer. That we trust you that you're buying this for your mom.
And I remember that's when we started buying cigarettes for the other kids and sold them for money.
Oh, smart.
They were like, oh, your mother's smoking a lot these days. And I'm like, pretty stressful.
I miss those days. Now you see a kid walking down the street by himself. You're ready to call the cops. I saw an 8-year-old walking down the street by himself.
Yeah.
He's abandoned.
What are you, nuts?
Yeah, I know.
Hey, look at my face. Do I look like a raccoon?
A little bit.
Yeah, like Rocky Raccoon?
Yeah, a little bit.
Nah.
Yeah, you do a little.
Really? Hey, you think I look bad? You ought to see the other guy's knuckles.
No, that's good. What am I?
I was trying to be coy. I was trying to be...
Oh, yeah, sorry. I was trying to be sly,
not Sylvester Stallone.
We're already wrapping up. What time is it? What time did we start?
It's been about 45 minutes, I think.
Oh.
Sorry, I didn't mean to be a buzzkill.
A little bit. No, we'll end up the scene, though. You're right. You're absolutely right. This is a good... We'll end up this good night.
Yeah. I was just...
If you think I look bad, you ought to see that guy's knuckles. It's true. It's true.
Well, would the knuckles look bad?
Sure. Like
being wrapped up and all that?
Yeah, they look... They're pretty...
You're still pounding something. I can only imagine. You know, in all the fights that I've been in, that's been my experience. They thought it was funny.
Anyway, yo, good night.
Okay, night. Kid.
So when do you stop kissing your son on the lips?
I don't have a son.
Or a child.
Never.
Everyone's different about that. I'm not saying I give my kids a kiss on top of the head. They're at the age now where it's on top of the head.
You know, there was I saw a special the other day on the Petty family, Richard Petty. You know, like it's like a NASCAR dynasty.
Okay.
And Kyle Petty was Richard Petty's son, and then he had a son as well that was a race car driver, and they had a very, very close relationship. And I was watching this, and he was a grown man. He was in his early 20s, and they were both in the same racing team together, and they kissed each other on the lips when they were like, okay, good luck, have a good race. They kissed each other on the lips, and these are two grown men, and I was like, that's really cute. They're best of friends. They love each other so dearly.
Oh, wow.
When was the last time you kissed out on lips?
Oh, it's been a long time. I couldn't even imagine.
Why would you imagine?
You know, what about you?
Well, I could definitely say this. My dad's 73 right now, and I don't kiss him on the lips. But I kiss him on the cheek or the head or...
That's wonderful.
Wherever.
I admire that. Like, don't get me wrong. I think it's great. I just...
At some point, it becomes too late to reintroduce.
Yeah. That's what it is.
If it stops at some point, and it's been like 40 years, like...
Yeah.
Dad, let's bring back kissing.
Yeah, so if I started kissing my dad on his top of his, you know, receding hairline forehead, Dad... Sorry. I don't know.
Oh, my kid, I don't know. My oldest is 8.
Like, well, I have a 20-year-old son. There's no... If he kissed me on the cheek, I'd be like, that's a little weird. I'd be like, I mean, take it back. Just like, even out of love. Because like Ruben said, it's never happened.
I had some Italian customers come by, and I know that the guy is the same age as me, and his dad was there. And he called him, Papa.
Hey, Papa.
And then they look... But like I thought it was nice.
Sure, that's what I mean. It's you can tell when it's something that people have done for years, and that's what they do.
Sure, yeah. As opposed to custom.
Well, we're very Protestant and cold over here in North America.
I think so.
It's like my wife is from Brazil, and right. And like that's one of the like it when is. They when they're doing like a text message or an email, they end their note with saying beijo, which is kisses, right? And they always kiss everyone gives each other a little kiss.
Hmm.
Right, and they'll do this like the, like this like sure, where they don't make the contact, right. But they do the noise.
Sure,
right. Like so that. When I'm in Brazil, I become very Brazilian, and I'm a very open person anyway, right? Uh-huh. But here in Canada, we're very cold people.
We are, as far as kissing,
it's so many things. We're so cold in so many ways.
But they're Italian,
Dad.
So the kissing would have made sense for them, culturally. If we're speaking of that,
it's there. He's quite the little drawer there, eh? Imagine if your 12-year-old son was drawing like that. That'd be pretty great.
Or 14-year-old. You think if he could draw a bear that well, Miss DuPont.
Miss DuPont was really lacking to do details.
I think Miss DuPont might have been like in a hasty sort of let's get this on paper right now.
Or it was just the beginning.
I'll finish this later.
Maybe it was just the beginning. It's going to be fleshed out literally later.
Or it's like a flip book and you just found the first page.
Yeah, I love it. Miss DuPont, you're a beautiful woman.
Madame DuPont.
Well, thanks. I appreciate it.
I love it.
Mark. Okay. Maybe you can show me your English teacher.
Pretty hot, too.
Nah.
Yeah.
Good night, kid.
Okay.
I never had a crush on any of my teachers.
All right. So I did on my, I think we talked about this before, my math 12 teacher. She was a freshman. So I'm in, sorry, math 11. I was in grade 12, but it was math 11. And she was a pretty fresh university kind of grad. So she was early 20s. What was her name? I want to go with Miss Weber or something like that. But oh boy, the testosterone from the boys and her just enjoying it. You could tell all the guys. This is 1993, so there was no.
You guys had no control.
No, but I mean, it wasn't anything like horrible. But we made it. No, we were openly flirting with her. Absolutely
disgusting.
But just by being extra goofy. Funny,
like banging erasers for her,
cleaning
the chalkboard.
That's right. We'd always
apples.
We'd be like extra good students. Oh yes, whatever you want. You know, we'd be that kind of goofy.
I wonder what her self esteem took a dive. Like 1 year, that stops happening.
It stops happening. Well, it didn't stop that year. She, anyways. So Paul wants me to go on. No, I think we'll stop there. So. My voice can't take much more. All right. So thank you for listening to our episode 105 live recording. And hope you enjoyed Madame DuPont, her breakdown episode. It was a fun little scene. And anything you want to say there before we close?
Ding, ding.
All right. And live video.